everybody, and welcome back to Thundercast, ThunderTech's regular podcast delivering ideas, insight, and innovation to the middle market. I'm your host, Craig Israel, Creative Director here at ThunderTech. Today's pod is another in our series of podcasts highlighting articles from our 2019 Summer Marketing Trends publication, where we report on the emerging trends, techniques, and topics of interest to middle market businesses. You can get your very own digital copy right now at thundertech.com/summerreader2019. That's summerreader2019. On today's pod, we're talking about that tried and true method of connecting with customers and prospects, the trade show. But this isn't your father's trade show booth. So to help us explore this topic, I have with me two very special guests in the studio. First, Madeline Hoyle, Senior User Experience Designer at ThunderTech, and Dan Lyons, Digital Marketing Team Lead at ThunderTech. Hey, guys.
Hey there.
Howdy.
So welcome back to the podcast. So today we're talking about the article that actually all three of us were interviewed for in the Trends publication, talking about trade shows, trade show booths, and how to add some digital components before and after the fact to really up your trade show game. So let me start by, you know, outlining trade shows. I think to the casual listener, they might think that trade shows are a necessary evil, but really kind of outdated if you put out, you know, stress balls and free pens and sell sheets, but the article outlines that savvy marketers are really leveraging new technology to make their trade show experiences more engaging and more interesting to attendees. So, Madeline, let's start with you, because I know that you've done a lot of work here at ThunderTech with some of our customers for trade show experiences, bringing digital components into it. So what kind of stuff have you brought to the table for our customers?
Yeah. I think one of the things that we've really been able to provide as a great value to our clients is leveraging work that we've already, you know, both us as the agency and them as the client, that we've both worked together to create these platforms, you know, their website, their new content management system, and being able to utilize those to deploy content into the trade show booth. Sometimes content that you wouldn't otherwise be able to fit into the booth, or be able to demonstrate products that you otherwise wouldn't be able to physically bring into the booth. Those sorts of transformations really have a lot of value to the clients, and it's something that we've been able to do with a lot of our clients. It's been great.
Yeah, so practically you're talking about it can be something as simple as taking some website content or other collateral and just putting on an iPad or digital signage, right?
Yeah. Generally, if you have a larger screen, most of our clients opt for larger displays. It can be something that helps to bring visitors into the trade show booth, catch people's eye from across the aisles, and bring people into the space to interact with that content.
Yeah, and like you said, that this doesn't have to be something you build from scratch. You can really leverage a lot of content that might already be created or they might already be using and just, you know, use that cope method, create once, publish elsewhere, that we like to talk about, just to, you know, bring some extra pizzazz to the booth. So a couple other things that we've seen people bring to trade show booths are things like virtual reality or augmented reality. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, that kind of stuff that we're seeing in more and more of these trade show booths?
Yeah, we're definitely on the cusp of, a bigger transformation of trade show booths than we've seen in the past, with some of these new technologies being more accessible. So with a VR experience, that could be something that can really help these individuals walk away from the trade show with a unique experience that they wouldn't have otherwise been able to get with this brand. So if that's, you know, a hands-on experience, if that's being able to walk around a virtual space or interact with a virtual product, you know, some of our clients have more industrial scale machinery, mm-hmm. Products, things that you wouldn't normally be able to bring into, you know, a 10 by 10 or larger trade show space. And something like VR can be a great way to bring that experience into the booth.
So, Madeline, I think a lot of this boils down to something that you call it in the article, is that, you know, you want some sort of wow factor in your booth, something that, like you said earlier, really brings somebody in and allows them to interact with your products. And I think that's an interesting aspect of like a virtual reality experience, is it's not just necessarily looking at things in a 3D environment. It actually can be interactive to a degree, right?
So I think that the next step from there is really delivering on sort of this promise. So you're seeing something very interesting. You're seeing people interacting with a VR equipment. And being able to provide an experience that is actually going to be memorable for the trade show goer, I think is the next step there. And so there's different things that you can do, one of which is just a very simple, it's essentially a 3D movie. Sometimes it can also be a 360-degree 3D movie, or more limited from that, essentially where the user can actually turn their head and see different details. So you can have essentially a very simple guided tour shot with a spherical or 3D camera. In other cases, you can actually, if you're actually rendering the 3D objects in the space, you can do something what's sometimes called room scale VR. That would allow someone to actually potentially walk around a physical product, but in the virtual space, or can walk around in a 3D environment. Now, those are sort of different scales of what can be offered in VR, but they're all very interesting. Using different controllers and things, you can also provide interaction. But for something like a trade show experience, you'd really want to consider what you want the trade show goer to walk away with. Do you want them to be more informed? Do you want them to be intrigued? Do you want them to go back to their colleagues and tell them about the great experience they had with your brand? Lots of options to consider.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, that it all boils down to, you know, the basics of good marketing. You want to be memorable. If you give this amazing, you know, 3D virtual reality experience, but it doesn't stick with anybody, that they don't get anything out of it, then you've invested a lot of money in something that doesn't really go very far. So speaking of investments, I wanted to call out something else that was mentioned in the article. For one of our clients, OSI, they make industrial caulking and other, you know, foam and other building products. They invested in what they call the OSI Roadshow. So it's essentially a semi that they haul around to trade shows and work sites and other events. And it's essentially a giant mobile showroom where you can go in and interact with their products and get a little bit of training. What I find interesting with that, even though it's a little outside of your traditional 10x10 trade show booth, that they've been using it in interesting ways, not just to sell products, but they also use it as part of their educational track, so that they haul to a work site, they bring in, you know, their customers, train them on how to actually use the products through, you know, hands-on stuff, through video, so that they're getting some extra mileage out of their investment, more so than just, you know, doing a couple trade shows a year. All right, so Dan, I want to bring you into the conversation, because in the article you're mentioned, there's a lot you can do through digital and marketing animation to get the most out of your trade show experience, both before, during, and after the show. So let's start with before.
So before, everyone wants to know, when is the next trade show, who's going to be there, what are they promoting, what are they selling, and the best way to kind of get that across at an affordable and efficient price is display ads. If you're not familiar with those are your banner ads that you see on websites, on your phone, whether you're in a mobile app. It's that little ad that you think is really obnoxious, but you end up clicking on it or you end up looking at it, and you actually get a little bit of awareness, and it's a touch point for a lot of brands out there these days.
Mm-hmm. All right, so that helps awareness for the show. What can actually be done, you know, while you're at the trade show?
So while you're at the trade show, there's a couple things that we can do. The first thing would be actually using those banner ads as well in a condensed area, almost what we would call a geofence. And what we're doing with that is delivering in a small radius, whether it's a mile, 2 miles, 3 miles. We can even go as low as a half mile right around the location. We're condensing all of your display ads in one small area, which is increasing those touch points and ultimately raising your brand awareness at the campaign or at the trade show.
Yeah, so that the geofence is centered on like the trade show hall or the venue, so that only people who are at or near the venue are going to see these ads.
Yeah. One thing that I do want to touch on is, for example, Madeline talked about it earlier, was you have a virtual reality or you're offering some product and you want to be unique and you want to be different. You have that uniqueness and that different aspect, and someone's like, okay, that was a great experience. How can we retarget that person and keep that brand going in their mind? Yeah. So they don't forget about you after their virtual reality experience. That's through banner ads.
Yeah. And then after the fact?
After the fact, there's a couple other options. You can remarket anyone through banner ads that attended the trade show, because if they're visiting a specific landing page, you can then deliver them ads. You need a pretty good-sized audience for this. I want to make that clear. This isn't for every single trade show. It's more for the larger ones.
Yeah.
Another tactic you could do actually is marketing automation, and that is delivering a personalized message to the person that you met with, or you can also create the connection between them and the salesperson they met and actually continue that relationship and grow that relationship so that they know that they're not just another person that's receiving the exact same marketing collateral or email that everyone else is getting that went to that specific trade show.
Right. So let me loop back for a second, Madeline. If I'm a small middle market business and I have a traditional 10 by 10 booth with a table and some free pens, what would be a way for me to dip my toe into more digital executions and to enhance my booth experience?
Yeah, you have a lot of options ahead of you, and I think you'd want to consider what you offer as an organization and as a brand, and what you offer that would be interesting for those trade show visitors. So as an example, if you have a lot of products that are maybe a little difficult to describe with the functionality, or you offer maybe complex services, having a video in your booth might be a great way to get your toes wet.
Yeah.
So that could be something as simple as producing a short video and having that in your booth on a TV mounted on the wall, or on a tablet that someone can kind of look through some different videos. You can also include photos. If you have a website that you think that you're proud of and you want to include, you can always set that up with a smaller touchscreen computer, an all-in-one type of computer, and just invite folks to interact with it. Train your folks representing your brands in your booth to walk folks through it. You can also easily get started with collecting information from trade show visitors, such as their email address, contact information, if you want to get them signed up for email newsletters and things like that. It's surprisingly inexpensive to get started with stuff like that.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, that you don't have to dump a ton of money into some sort of virtual reality experience or giant touch screens, that you can start with something as small as an iPad. All right, Dan, same question to you. If I'm a smaller business looking to up my trade show game and I don't have the budget to execute everything that you talked about earlier, what's a good first step to get started with?
Good first step would definitely be the marketing automation aspect if you have a platform already. If you have the platform already, it's great. You can actually deliver that personalized message, continue the relationships, and then deliver materials, whether that's an ebook or product detail pages or anything else that you have that's marketing collateral that you can cope. I know that we mentioned cope earlier, so yep. I want to keep that concept in mind. It's going to save you a lot of money. If you don't have a marketing automation platform, I would definitely recommend the geofencing and just try to create some really strong and emotional display ads.
Cool. All right, that will do it for Thundercast this week. Special thanks to Madeline and Dan for coming in and talking to us. If you like this podcast, you can subscribe to Thundercast on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever fine podcasts are sold. This pod was part of our 2019 Trends series, which you can download right now at thundertech.com/summerreader2019. If you're dying to hear more, including previous trends topics, you can find our full library of 100-plus past episodes on our website at thundertech.com/podcast. Thundercast is a production of Thundertech, an integrated agency for the connected world, serving clients in Cleveland, Detroit, Chicago, New York, across the nation, and around the world. Your host is me, Craig Israel. This episode was recorded and edited by Nat Stevens. Our production coordinator is Danielle Kupfer. Thanks for listening.